If you sail,
I sail in sailing
over the sea.
Or will you wait for me?
Louis Armstrong once said Bing Crosby's voice was like gold being poured out of a cup.
He changed the way people sang. He completely started something new.
Just found a hole in my shoe and my stocking shows through.
Bing was one of the most beloved and bankable music and movie stars of the 20th century.
For any villains we may meet, we haven't any fear.
Paramount will protect us cause we're signed for 5 more years.
He was also one of Hollywood's busiest entertainers, and it was his teaming with Bob Hope that set the bar for those modern day bromance movies.
Dad and Bob would go to the golf course, which was across the street from Warner Brothers, during lunch, and then the ADs would have to go find them on whatever hole they were at to get them to come back to finish. But they had such a good time.
Come on, Daddy, Bing's waiting for us in the boat. We'll take everybody with us on the road to Zanzibar.
The Seven Road films became the highest-grossing franchise until James Bond came along.
I'm dreaming of a white Christmas.
And in the same year that Bing and Bob just released like Road to Zanzibar, Bing recorded the song that has become the soundtrack of Christmas.
He was singing so simply and so from his heart, and I think that translates over decades. So it's not something that's limited to a certain era. You can hear his voice today and go, oh, that really works.
Well, don't just stand there.
The versatile singer often shared the spotlight. Bing worked closely with many other artists.
And you'll fall asleep.
His most frequent partner in the 50s was George Clooney's aunt, Rosemary.
And he was also willing to sing with anybody.
Love forever.
That's pretty extraordinary, which, you know, can take us to David Bowie.
This is my son's favorite. Do you know this one?
Oh, I do indeed. It's a lovely thing.
In 1977, the crooner and rock's androgynous Thin White Duke recorded the most unlikely of duets.
David Bowie said, no, I don't want to do that. And David's mother said, no, you have to sing with Bing Crosby.
This is the great Bing
exactly.
Crosby.
So thank you, Mrs. Bowie.
They told me, ba-rum-ba-bum-bum.
My brother and I were on the set, and we were so interested to see how this would pan out.
I pray my wish will come true. I swore my child and your child too.
And you think there's no way those two people are gonna work it. And not only did they work it, but they made magic.
Just a month after his duet with David Bowie, Bing died doing what he loved.
He shot 80, played a fantastic round of golf, was walking up to the locker room, and went before he was old or sick or out of control of his faculties and his people. And I think his timing was, in typical Crosby fashion, impeccable.
Mary Frances, two-year-old daughter of Bing and Kathy, is taking her Red Cross beginner swimming test.
Just fit the battle of Jericho.
Bing was in his 70s when he died, and Mary feels blessed she had 18 years with her dad. Unfortunately, Bing's children from his first marriage didn't have the same warm and fun-loving upbringing.
His first family came along. He wasn't around at all. He was working. He was at the top of the heap, and he just wasn't there. And so when we were born, he really wanted to be there and to do it differently. And so we grew up outside of Hollywood. He didn't think it was a great place to raise kids. So we grew up outside of San Francisco. And we had so much time with him. I'm so grateful.
There they are. Great brood.
Mary paints a picture of a loving dad, but Bing was estranged from his four sons from his first marriage. In 1983, his eldest son, Gary, wrote a shocking tell-all.
I knew Gary. He was someone that I actually had contact with, and he was one of the angrier men I've known. But he also had been a raging alcoholic and become sober, and we went out to lunch after that book came out, and he literally told me in tears that they had said, the worse this is, the more books will sell. And he apologized to me for that. I felt like it doesn't really matter because you've trashed your father, and that's permanent. People can always trash talk. It's the easiest thing to do. You can always lower the bar.
Mary grew up in front of the camera, so it was only natural she'd choose a career in showbiz. But her pedigree almost cost her the role of a lifetime, that of JR's mistress, Kristen Shepherd, in Dallas.
You're what they call a devious wench.
Why, JR, I thought you liked devious.
They liked me, but they were very concerned because I was Bing's daughter. And they weren't sure if the general public would accept Bing's daughter, White Christmas, doing all these nasty, horrible things with JR. So they decided to take a chance, and I'm so glad that they did, and I think they were glad too.
At the end of the third season, Dallas aired what is arguably the greatest global cliffhanger in television history. Who shot JR?
Weeks of waiting for Dallas fans have come to an end with the shooting of the villain of the series, JR Ewing.
After 8 months of speculation, 350 million viewers, including the Queen and the Queen Mother, tuned in when it was revealed it was Kristen who pulled the trigger.
It was you, Kristen, who shot JR.
There was so much media interest in finding out who was the culprit that producers shot many different versions.
Everybody got to shoot Larry. Larry got to shoot himself. The makeup lady got to shoot Larry. The producers got to shoot Larry. And so if the secret had gotten out, or if one of the ladies, if Linda or Victoria had wanted too much money, then they would have been the one to shoot him. So they were incredibly smart about how they did it. Nobody, except for probably Larry and the producers, knew 100% for sure until it came out.
So even you didn't know. Your storyline may have been a ruse.
Larry
perhaps
took me aside and said, "Darling, I think you might want to get a publicity person." And I thought, okay.
These days, Mary is content being a mum of two and keeping her famous dad's legacy alive. Last year, the family collaborated with the London Symphony Orchestra on an album that breathed new life into some of Bing's most prized festive songs.
After he died, it was incredibly bittersweet because I was so happy to hear his voice and that people could hear him, and he was so much part of the holidays. But I was so sad because I missed him so desperately. Now, decades later, it makes me nothing but filled with joy. And it makes me very happy that our children get to hear him.
All your Christmases be white.